us, Heavenly Father, to come into thy holy presence. O Lord, we thank thee we may come in the name of the eternal Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. We praise thee and thank thee for our dear Saviour. We thank thee for all that he's done for us on Calvary's cross to purge away our sin and offer up a perfect righteousness on our behalf. We praise thee and thank thee for the sure and certain access into thy holy presence that we have by him. And O Lord, we come as thy children to call upon thy name. Look upon us now, pardon and forgive us our sin. Receive us, we ask. O Lord, bless our hearts as we come before thee. Grant us true earnestness and a desire for thy word and for thy truth this night. Look upon each one. Thou knowest all about us. Thou knowest what we have done. Thou knowest our whole lives. O Lord, bless us now in thy forgiving love and enrich us and build us up and strengthen us, and receive now our adoration and our worship. We ask these things in the name of our Saviour, for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing together the hymn number 300. Hymn number 300. The Lord shall come, the earth shall quake. Their own arm saved them, but of thy right hand and thine arm, by the light of thy countenance, because thou hadst a favour unto them. Thou art my King, O God, command deliverances for Jacob. Through thee will we push down our enemies, through thy name will we tread them under that rise up against us. For I will not trust in my bow, neither shall my sword save me, but thou hast saved us from our enemies, and hast put them to shame that hated us. In God we boast all the day long, and praise thy name for ever. But thou hast cast off and put us to shame, and goest not forth with our armies. Thou makest us to turn back from the enemy, and they which hate us spoil for themselves. Thou hast given us like sheep appointed for meat, and hast scattered us among the heathen. Thou sellest thy people for naught, and dost not increase thy wealth by their price. Thou makest us a reproach to our neighbours, a scorn and a derision to them that are round about us. Thou makest us a byword among the heathen, a shaking of the head among the people. My confusion is continually before me, and the shame of my face hath covered me, for the voice of him that reproacheth and blasphemeth by reason of the enemy and avenger. All this is come upon us, yet have we not forgotten thee, neither have we dealt falsely in thy covenant. Our heart is not turned back, neither have our steps declined from thy way. Though thou hast sore broken us in the place of dragons, and covered us with the shadow of death, if we have forgotten the name of our God, or stretched out our hands to a strange God, shall not God search this out? For he knoweth the secrets of the heart. Yea, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Awake, why sleepest thou, O Lord? Arise, cast us not off for ever. Wherefore hidest thou thy face, and forgettest our affliction and our oppression? For our soul is bowed down to the dust, our belly cleaveth unto the earth. Arise for our help, and redeem us for thy mercy's sake. We call at his blessing to the reading of his word. Let's sing together the hymn number 119, part 15. Hymn 119, part 15. Oh, how the wonders of thy law my soul to act obedience for.
pastor, Dr. Peter Masters. Following the results of this Bible study, we hope you will all stay for fellowship and refreshments. Recordings of this evening ministry will be available. A magazine, Sword and Travel, can be obtained, and our bookshop will be open. Other audio and video recordings of recent ministry are available, and last Sunday's ministry with the gospel message from 2 Corinthians 5:17, titled The Recreation of Life. On Sunday, our teaching service is delivered in the morning, when the ministry will continue in the light of John 17, revealing the commandments. And our evangelistic service is at 6:30 in the evening. The preacher, God willing, will be our pastor. Let us again join in prayer together. Oh, our Father, we again thank thee for mercies and grace which brought us hitherto, yet again to worship and to yield of ourselves to hear thy word. Oh Lord, be pleased to receive us anew. Forgive us all our transgressions and our many failings and our shortcomings. Oh gracious God, and bless us now. Meet us, gracious God, around thy mercy seat to which we come, to yield up ourselves to thee. Oh, we thank thee again for Jesus Christ, our Lord, and our dear loving Saviour, who left the courts of heaven to be our Saviour, who came and assumed our humanity, gracious God, that he should bear and felt and borne all the punishment which was due to us for all our waywardness and sin, for all our transgressions before thee. And oh, we come, Lord, to lift it up in our hearts and lives, and in the lives of others, Lord, through the preached word. And we come again with thanksgiving around thy mercy seat, and plead that thou be pleased to come down now, Lord, by thy gracious spirit, warm our hearts, O gracious God, and make us feel thy presence here. And oh, we come again to thank thee for ministry in this place. We come to thank thee, O Lord, for the many who continue to be found in this place around thy holy word. And oh Lord, the vast number of children and young people in our midst and at the missions, Lord, it is of thy doing, and we thank thee for these things. Oh Lord, we thank thee for thy dear people as they continue to come into this place for worship, and we do bring before thee those that are sick and laid aside. We do bring those that are elderly, weak and infirm, and pray that it may please thee to bless them. Heal and restore the sick among us, gracious God, and bless, we beseech thee, O Lord our God, that we may be, O Lord, as it were, a force to be reckoned within the world and in our community, in this society in which thou hast set us, but that we might proclaim Christ and lift him up before the world. O Lord our God, we thank thee, our gracious God, for the regular proclamation of the gospel and the teaching, instructive ministry which we continue to receive in this place. O Lord, help us that these things which we have heard may never, O Lord our God, allowed to be let slip and to forget them, but that thou be pleased to resuscitate the faculties of the memory, that we might recall these things and apply them daily, Lord, as need be, to our lives. O gracious God, we thank thee for those men we support overseas in their ministry and work, and we cry aloud unto thee that it may please thee to bless them. Our gracious God, we do think of the tragedy, O gracious God, in recent days, Lord, in Zimbabwe, O gracious God, and in Africa, in Botswana, in those areas, Lord, where floods have devastated lives and houses and many, Lord, being made homeless. We do pray for those people, O Lord our God, on whom such tragedy has come. We do think particularly, O gracious God, churches there we support in Zimbabwe and pray, Lord, that it may please thee to bless them. Oh, that relief, oh gracious God, might reach those, Lord our God, from whom it is necessary, Lord, to rescue further. Oh, Lord our God, we see many tragedies in our world. We hear of many trials and persecution. And we long, gracious God, that thy people may know freedom and liberty to live their lives and to preach the gospel. And oh, what can we say, O Lord our God, in such evil times as this in which we live? But come, Lord Jesus, come, for we anticipate a coming day, O Lord our God. But before that awful day comes, Lord, we long to reach souls. We long to reach souls for him, O gracious God, and pray to this end that it may please thee to bless the churches. And now as we come to open thy holy word, Lord, look upon thy servant, we pray. Visit him by thy spirit, fill him with zeal, clarity, health and strength, Lord, for the hour. But O Lord our God, open our hearts to receive this oracle of thee, the living God. Oh Lord, we pray, look to thee for these blessings in the precious name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, and for his sake. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing together the hymn number 219. Hymn number 219. I will sing the wondrous story of Christ who died for me.
Thank you.
chapter, which is a review of the winning of the conquest in the north of the Promised Land, the Northern Confederacy against the children of Israel, and the details of all the battles that are really covered in chapter 11 are listed out in the following chapters: the victories, the places, the kings, and the distribution of the portions of the land to the tribes of Israel. But here is a tremendous summary, overview chapter of the Northern Conquest. And as I was mentioning last study, up until now, everything has gone at express speed for the Southern Conquest. But now this 11th chapter represents an unmistakable change of pace will appear, and what happens in this chapter is taking place over a period of time of some 6.5-7 years. So it's the long part of the conflict, and it begins here in the first verse. And my first heading will have a number of headings to try to elicit the application of the chapter this evening. First heading will be satanic build-up. There's a build-up here in the beginning of this chapter. The Northern Confederacy assembles. It came to pass when Jabin, not the name of the king of Hazor, or Hazor, as it's called today in the Jewish manner, with so much tourism, it came to pass when Jabin, well, that's his hereditary title rather than his name, king of Hazor, had heard those things, the conquest of the south, that he formed a confederacy or a coalition of northern kingdoms. He only gets some of them, and that's probably because he took so long. There was a long delay before the north reacted to the conquest of the south. Generally, the view is taken that this was of God, that the kings of the north were in a kind of stupor and took a long time to collect their wits and to respond. And it gave the Israelites time to recover, time to prepare, time to be built up in faith, waiting for the major battles. Because the north would be much more difficult. The city-states were much larger, enemies therefore more numerous, and what's more, they were better equipped. Now they would be up against cavalry. They'd never met cavalry before. And chariots, iron chariots, and so on. So much more sophisticated equipment of war. And these people were practiced in warfare. The city-states were frequently thrusting away marauders into the land and in conflict with each other. So they were armed to the teeth. And now, when they get together in a confederacy, they're particularly dangerous. So these were formidable enemies, and the Israelites would soon be seeing thousands upon thousands of them arranged against them. There was a wait, a long period, and we see this kind of thing reflected in church history repeatedly. We see it in a strange way in our own land. You get times of tremendous spiritual awareness and blessing, and the gospel spreads. You think of the 19th century, but it's awakening, and it's tremendous preponderance of churches and evangelical preachers. And then towards the end of the 19th century, problems begin to come in. But the attack of Satan, first of all, is on the churches. It's curious how the churches, evangelical, Bible-believing churches, large numbers of them at first, had a kind of rest or respite from the hostility of the world,
from the last part of the 19th century into the 20th century. The attacks are mainly theological. From within the church, the attacks, liberalism, higher criticism, and so on, and the world left us comparatively alone. In fact, the world was quite friendly to the church, if the world can ever be said to be friendly to the church. It tolerated the church. It put up with Christianity. It rather liked, or so it said, the Christian ethic. Nobody opposed the Christian ethic for many years. So we got rest from the world, and Satan's attacks were mainly within. And then suddenly you come to relatively modern times. You come to the 1960s, and suddenly, like a bombshell, the permissive society bursts in. And now the world is beginning to attack the church. Suddenly the great guns of militant atheism are turned upon religion, and there's a direct assault. Suddenly the alternative sexual morality arises and is most vigorously promoted. And then, of course, a great campaign in entertainment music to pollute the minds and hearts of the devil, to use that for the obstruction of thinking, and so on. And suddenly, you've got militant atheism coming at you in all forms, and taking advantage of technological advance. So the media is on the side of the world, and the children are now brainwashed and programmed to see and to absorb and take in terrible things through social media and so on. Everything seems to be pitched against belief, against Christ, against the church of Christ and the word of God. And yet we had rest for some time. You always see these things pre-shadowed, but then cycle in history ever afterwards. So there's that period of rest, and then everything bursts forth with the Northern Confederacy. And I think these things are intended for our help and for our instruction. Of course, we are to look to him in every situation, in every trial. So verse down here in verse 5, let me read verse 4. They went out, they and all their hosts with them, much people, even as the sand that is upon the seashore in multitude, with horses and chariots very many. And when all these kings were met together, they came and pitched together the waters of Merom to fight against the Lord. And the Lord said unto Joshua, verse 6, which has been said before in the events of the previous chapter, be not afraid because of them. Now that's highly significant. Joshua had been in this predicament before, in conflict, and the Lord had used precisely these words recorded in chapter 10. Now he's seasoned, he's experienced, and yet the counsel is the same. Be not afraid because of them. And it's reflected in our lives. We have difficult experiences, very many of them, trials and tribulations, and we're taught to trust in the things of God and to solve our problems by prayer and hold ourselves in and together, and the Lord sees us through. You'd think we would be seasoned, but then in no time another trial comes and we need exactly the same counsel. Be not afraid. Our tendency is to go to pieces as though we'd never proved the Lord before, as we have. It's so strange. But here it is, be not afraid of them. For tomorrow, about this time, will I deliver them up, all slain, before Israel. God is going to do the work. Thou shalt hop their horses and burn their chariots with fire. So we look to him in every trial, in every problem. Personal problems, church problems. So often people are plunged into difficulty.
difficulty or into depression, and we find we're giving the same counsel, we give it to ourselves also. Turn with me to a passage in Isaiah chapter 15. And here it is, one of the most famous passages in the Bible for personal spiritual direction. I'm going to read from verse 10. From verse 7, the great verse is verse 10. Verse 7, for the Lord God will help me. Therefore shall I not be confounded. Therefore have I set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be ashamed, says Isaiah. He is near that justifieth me. Who will contend with me? You can see this being quoted by the Apostle Paul in Romans 8. He is near that justifieth me. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who is mine adversary? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord God will help me. Who is he that shall condemn me? Lo, they all shall wax old as a garment, the moths shall eat them up. And the great verse, who is among you that feareth the Lord, that obeyeth the voice of his servant? Yet, let us insert that little word, that walketh in darkness and hath no light. Let him trust in the name of the Lord and stay upon his God. What a theme this used to be for Puritan sermons, the text of many great sermons. Who is among you that feareth the Lord, yet walketh in darkness, the child of light, walking in darkness? Thomas Goodwin, Thomas Watson had a very similar sermon. Richard Baxter made great use of this in his Causes and Cure of Melancholy, preached at St. Charles Cripplegate. Must have taken him 2 or 3 hours to preach it. Cripplegate morning exercises started at 6 one morning. Great crowds flowing into the street listening to him on the Causes and Cure of Melancholy, one of the great Puritan classics. All of them turned sooner or later to Isaiah chapter 50, verse 10. What does it mean? Well, as we stress so often, it means this. When your feeling system breaks down and will not cooperate, and you sense no joy in the Lord and no assurance, you can still function with your head. You don't need the feeling system to pray. It's nicer to have it operating. But when it forsakes you, you can still pray. You can still call upon God. You can still praise him. You can still bring your petitions before him. And so very often, even as we do so, like the psalmist of old, our hearts are warm and our feeling system reactivates. It's a system of response. It's a great privilege and comfort, but it isn't a necessity. And the very best prayers of all, and the very best praise, comes from hearts where the feeling system is temporarily out of action, because everything is by the law of faith, and the Lord appreciates that above everything else. Well, here's Isaiah 10. Who is among you that feareth the Lord, and you obey him, and yet just now there's darkness? Well, you can imagine what it was like for Joshua, as the leader of the people, to be confronted by vast numbers and to suppress fear and to put his trust entirely in the Lord. Well, I go to another edict, and it'll be this, and I'll be looking down at verse 6, and it'll be, God gave them very limited methods to work with. Be not afraid of them, for tomorrow about this time will I deliver them up all slain before Israel. Thou shalt hop their horses, the modern versions say hamstring their horses, and burn their chariots with fire. We might tend to recoil at the idea of hamstringing the horses. Nobody's quite sure what they did with those horses. The Hebrew is not that plain. The Hebrew verb says something like this: pluck out the horses. And the general assumption is that is to hamstring the horse. It isn't necessarily so. It may have been that they were actually executing the horses. Not very nice thing to talk about, but by severing the horse's main tendon and artery, so that the horse died very quickly, or it may be they had some way of dealing with the horse more gently, so that it was just disabled and unfit for warlike purposes. And yet there are also many old writers who think that the Hebrew verb just as likely refers to the castration of the horse, so that these fierce, trained stallions were useless for warfare purposes. But the favorite view is that it's a form of execution of horses, partly so that the Israelites would never use them themselves. God wanted them to be restricted with the methods at their disposal, so that they never look back on these battles and say, we won that because we seized all the horses and the chariots and the technology saved the day for us. They wouldn't be able to say that. They were just with the basic and simple weapons, relying on the power and the help of God. And the reason why all the writers think execution of the horse was in mind was so that the enemy couldn't escape on the mine. These things are debated endlessly, but nobody's 100% sure what is implied by the original Hebrew verb. But the main thing here is that the Israelites were not going to be able to use them. What we could do, Joshua's captains may have said, what we could do with all these chariots, if we had them, if we took them, but no, the instruction of God is get rid of them, destroy them. They're not available to you. And it's so with us. God has given us simple methods. The word and prayer. The word and prayer. Yes, we can use amplifiers to make our voices heard and things of this kind. Of course we can. But we have to be careful. I remember some while going back 40 years, this building, we used to lend it to a certain missionary society for once a year, like we still do for the Trinitarians. But this is another society that I have in mind. And they used to come on a Saturday and use the main church and bring people from all over the country to their annual meetings. And something that's rather amused me is that they used to festoon the platform with microphones. Now this doesn't mean much now, we're not impressed by microphones anymore. But 30, 40 years ago, they bought about 7 or 8 microphones, boom microphones, different shapes and sizes and stands, and set them all up. It looked as though the world's press were arriving. And ultimately, they were all, I believe, plugged into one mixer, which went into the church's system anyway. So what was the point of all these microphones? Well, the only point is it was for show. Maybe it made them feel more special. And all these important-looking microphones everywhere. It wasn't achieving anything. You give a speaker half a dozen or more microphones, it doesn't make him any more acceptable. But anyway, there it was. It felt important. It felt very special. Well, that's only a small thing. But that's happening on a massive scale all around us today. And it's comical. And Calvin has a beautiful comment on this verse, at the destruction of the chariots and horses. And he says, showy equipment dazzles the eye and intoxicates the mind with confidence. And that's a perfect assessment. So today they go for showy equipment. I was being told a few years ago who had been involved in the organising of one of our national Christian conferences, that this particular conference had the use of two or three very large churches in the resort in which the conference was held, which would easily accommodate the 1,000 or so people who they generally had at the conference. They didn't want to borrow those buildings. They didn't want to use those churches. They wanted a conference centre where they could have a big platform and all sorts of fancy things, and people who race up and down the platform and assemble bands and choirs and everything else. They didn't want anything churchy. This is, you please, for a church conference. The mind is intoxicated by paraphernalia and show this stuff. And you think you've only got to spend half a minute looking at the God channels on the television to see all these preachers of, I speak as an old man, but preachers of at least 50 years of age dressing like teenage pop stars. The things people will do because they think it advances the gospel and makes them more presentable. But it's all here. Get rid of the chariots. Get rid of the horses. You're given basic tools by the Lord. Trust him and the power of the word and the gospel and prayer. That's what God loves to bless. So this is really the second great point that comes through here. And let's just turn to Psalm 20. And verses 7 to 9. These are the principles that Israel learned in their better days. Some trust in chariots, and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. They are brought down and fallen, but we are risen and stand upright. Save, Lord, let the King hear us when we call. That's the principle that we have to work through. And we could look at Isaiah chapter 31, verses 1 to 3, where the Lord, through Isaiah, puts it in a negative form. Woe to them that go down to Egypt for help, and stay on horses and trust in chariots, because they are many, and in horsemen, because they are very strong. For they look not unto the Holy One of Israel, neither seek the Lord. Yet he also is wise, and will bring evil, and will not call back his words, but will arise against the house of the evildoers, and against the help of them that work iniquity. So when God's children resort to all sorts of fancy gimmicks and methods and showmanship, they turn God against them. And he will ensure that they do not work. And they do not succeed. So it's not just a matter of will they work or won't they. God will make sure they won't. They won't be true spiritual blessing. But we learn that back in Joshua and in chapter 11. Then we have a third heading, and it's this. This book, this chapter, teaches us to identify key issues. Look at verse 10. Joshua 11, verse 10. And Joshua at that time turned back, routed the northern confederacy, people from the different cities, their forces were running, but he desisted. And then he turned his attention to Hazor and smote the king thereof with the sword, for Hazor before time was the head of all those kingdoms. And he focused his attention on that chief city state that was leading the confederacy. And that was vital. If you break the city that's taken the initiative, then you break the whole energy of the confederacy. He identified the chief place and went for it. And that's what we have to do too. pivotal points, as far as to look at the history of the Christian Church, which had people who've been very good at identifying principal points. You think of the Reformation, you think of Calvin and Luther, unerringly they identified the chief points: justification by faith alone. When you think of all the things they could have quibbled about, and they did quibble about many things, and take Rome to task for many things, but they knew to identify the chief, central, pivotal issue, and to focus on that: justification by faith alone. The day could have been lost if they had utterly confused the minds of the people by presenting 100 different things. Luther started that way. The 95 Theses, nailed to the door of the castle church at Wittenberg, dart hither and thither, a light on this and that and something else. But within a year or two, he got it all in focus: justification by faith alone. A fulcrum, pivotal issue. And that's what he dealt with. Calvin and others followed suit, and that makes such a difference to get the whole heart of the ark. Luther was brilliant at this. Not at first, but he soon got to this. So there's Erasmus, and he writes his great missive against Luther. Luther waits 2 years, and then he replies. And although the book does wander about quite a bit, and very enjoyably and rewardingly, yet it's hit the pivotal issue: the bondage of the will. That's it, Luther. You've got it all. You understand the title of the book. You understand the entire thesis. It's all about the bondage of the will. Why should I be a Calvinist as opposed to being an Arminian? The bondage of the will. I'm going to elaborate on that now. But Luther, well, it was a genius born directly from God. He hits the pivotal issue time after time in his discussions and in his work and in his arguments. And there were many others too. So think of Spurgeon. It was Spurgeon who first identified the greatest enemy of the last quarter of the 19th century as being higher criticism. And he got it absolutely on target. That was his pivotal issue, and that's what he went for, and that was vital. Pivotal issue. Joshua's the same. You see the principle here. You've got the entire confederacy. What shall I do? I'll go for Hazel. Break Hazel, you'll break everything. And he was right. It's just a sort of mop-up operation after that. It's the same with, well, we'll be dealing with some of this at School of Theology. We have Dr. David Beale coming from the USA, whose books show great expertise in this area. And he'll be talking about men like Andrew Fuller and John Sutcliffe and William Carey. And they all got this great, together, this pivotal issue: a universal tender of salvation. And they broke the stranglehold of hyper-Calvinism in their day, and communicated it. They derived much of their impetus from the great American theologian Jonathan Edwards, but they distinctly saw the pivotal theological issue for Britain and brought into focus the necessity of the indiscriminate preaching of the gospel to all. These things are marvelous, and they had the pivotal issue. In more recent times, Henry Morris, the scientist, long gone to glory, focused on creation as a pivotal issue in modern thought, and galvanized evangelical thinkers to think of that. And, well, we could give many examples of people who hit. Martin Lloyd-Jones, he didn't get the charismatic movement, but he did get the necessity of expository preaching. Woke many people up to that. It hit difficult matters. How are you going to cure
evangelicalism, which has started to drift into shallow sentimentality and so on. What are you going to do to gird it up and pull it together and get people back to the scripture? And he saw the issue, the principle of expository preaching. And we thank God that people have focused on these great significant factors. And here it is, I see it back in verse 10 of Joshua 11. And Joshua turned back and took Hazel. And then the fourth heading, because I'm going to proceed quickly, that is down here in verse 12. And my heading will be complete obedience. And all the cities of those kings and all the kings of them did Joshua take and smote them with the edge of the sword. And he utterly destroyed them as Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded. Then, as for the cities, there's a digression into the cities on their mounds. But verse 15, as the Lord commanded Moses his servant, so did Moses command Joshua, and so did Joshua. He left nothing undone of all that the Lord commanded Moses. And you'll see, if you have a marginal reading, the margin warns you that the Hebrew literally says, he left nothing undone, he removed nothing. That's the way it's expressed in the original. Joshua removed nothing from the commands he was given. He followed them to the letter. There must be complete obedience. And that was the success of the conquest. Apart from periods in the life of David, there was never success for Israel as there was under Joshua. And the key is complete obedience. But today, there are churches, and indeed a whole movement of churches, these so-called missional churches. And they are deliberately leaving out half of the things that we argue are fundamental duties of Christian people, if they have the opportunity. Oh, they say, don't talk to us about Sunday schools for children. We're not interested in Sunday schools, and indeed even conservative churches these days. We start the Sunday school, we don't want to do that. We're to leave out nothing. The preaching of the gospel, every week, a specific, persuasive, dedicated gospel sermon. We don't want to do that. Woe is unto me, says Paul, if I preach not the gospel. It's a technical term in the Bible for the soul-saving doctrines of the gospel. But today we say, oh, I don't believe in that. And so many. One pastor was writing, he was invited to a well-known seminary in this country to speak about the necessity of dedicated gospel preaching. And he did so to the a couple of lecturers assembled, and nobody agreed with him. None of the lecturers, none of the seminarians. He was astonished. Nobody agreed with him. He didn't have a single ally. What a strange situation today. Oh, we won't obey that. We don't want to do that. We don't see eye to eye with that. Prayer meetings? We don't want dedicated prayer meetings. Now they're saying the evening services. You don't have to have an evening service. One service on the Lord's Day is quite enough. Then the rest of the day, we do what we like. The Lord's Day, Sabbatarianism, that's finished, old-fashioned, we don't want that. The great cry is, leave that up, leave that up, leave that up. But the whole success of Joshua, he left nothing undone, he left nothing out of all that the Lord commanded Moses. Same with us in our individual lives. Don't leave anything out.
Write all the headings you can think of in the back piece of paper in the back of your Bible. Review everything in life. Morals. We dare not leave out moral behavior. Kindness. We dare not leave out kindness and approachability. Witness. We dare not leave it out. The way we talk. Our speech. That has to be purged and sanctified. Also, thought life. What I daydream about. What I think about. What I imagine, what I fantasize, not only are unclean things banned, but we have to tear our minds away from self-centered things and covetousness. Career. Some people say I'm a Christian, but my career, that's all my instincts. What do I want? Service for the Lord. Devotions. There's so many departments in the Christian life to be watched. Honesty and stewardship. Many people don't steward. We don't do all the things that God has laid upon us. You cannot leave out a department. Sometimes there are teachers like this. John Piper man with his Christian hedonism, who has a tendency to so often boil all Christian conduct down to the enjoyment of God. So instead of being a multi-track thing where we've got to watch our lives at umpteen points, oh, forget all that, but just one thing. Well, this has been tried various times. There was a man, you know, the end of the 19th century, became very, very famous as a preacher named Andrew Murray. And this was his whole idea. Let go, let God focus on one thing. Just imagine what Jesus would have done and so on. And everything will work out. It won't. You've got to keep a check on all the departments of life. Am I doing this and this? Just like the Bible does. Like the psalmist does in Psalm 25. You read it carefully, he reviews every aspect of his life, brings it under the spotlight, and presents it to the Lord. And then my time is up, but very quickly, a fifth heading, glory to God, down here in verse 16. So Joshua took all that land. He's given the credit here in this simple historic record. Hills and all the south country and all the land of Goshen and the valley of the plain and the mountain of Israel and the valley of the same and the long list proceeds down to verse 18. Joshua made war a long time with all those kings. That's your big clue how long chapter 11 covers. But then if you turn to Psalm 44, which we read through our scripture reading, and quite intentionally, and the first three verses, which also reviews the history of Joshua, you make a strange discovery. Joshua isn't mentioned once. We have heard with our ears, oh God, our fathers have told us, in all probability King David is the author of this psalm. The reason is every now and then he goes to the singular. Verse 4, thou art my king, O God. Command deliverances for Jacob. That's very kingly language. There's probably King David. There's four instances of him speaking of himself. Anyway, back to verse 1. We have heard with our ears, O God, our fathers have told us what work thou didst in their days, in the times of old. How thou didst drive out the heathen with thy hand. Thou hast done it. Thy sword, thine arm, thy countenance, Joshua, has now disappeared. That's the way the Lord would have it. He's the instrument. has lost him. Because that's all he was, the instrument. It was all God's work. Have you noticed we're exactly the opposite way around from God? When we write church history, we focus on the heroes, the human heroes. He did this, he did that, he did something else. And then the very wonderful men, it's right we want to hear about them and know about them, but our tendency is to do so in a hero worship manner. Where people make so much of George Whitefield, you almost forget. Psalm 44 wouldn't mention the name of Whitefield. In this context, it would be all the Lord. And that's how we should think. It's God who does these things. The instrument could be anyone who God raised up and equipped. We won't make great fusses of the instruments. All due historical credit in the book of Joshua, his name is mentioned. It isn't mentioned anymore. It's all God's work. It's all his doing. Glory must be the Lord's. Less hero worship, more thanksgiving to Almighty God. And I just close then with one last point in this 11th chapter of Joshua. And I go down to verse 21, and this last point is about the giants of the mountains. And at that time came Joshua. Joshua 11, verse 21. And cut off the Anakims. Strictly that should be Anakim. That's plural too. From the mountains, from Hebron, from Dibon, from Enah, and from all the mountains of Judah and of Israel, Joshua destroyed them utterly with their cities. So there was none left in that region. The Anakim, by a time I turn you back to the book of Numbers, the Anakim, they were the problem. When the spies, the Moses had sent out to spy the land 40 years earlier, reported back, the thing that terrified all but Joshua and Caleb out of the spies was the Anakim. The giants of the hills. I don't know how they know, but some experts insist they were 7 or 8 feet tall and very heavily built. I never figured out how they know that, but anyway, I seem to be very confident about that. And in the days when battles were fought with spears and javelins and swords and so on, to see thousands of huge men like that facing you, and they could move like lightning. They'd grown up as mountain boys. They were agile, powerful, had seemingly endless stamina. The Anakim were left to the very last on Joshua's agenda. But it was through them that Israel never entered the promised land. The people were afraid of them. Only Caleb and Joshua insisted that the Anakim could be overcome by the power of God. And the turning back of the children of Israel was due to the Anakim. Now they're the last enemy to fall. The old Matthew Henry says that the very greatest trials of life are often left to the end. That's true. When hopefully one's faith and experience is built up to face them. But in the end, Joshua routs the Anakim. It's his last prize. It's his last reward. He was 40 when he first saw them. They're the cause of all the trouble, humanly speaking. And now he routs them. His final reward comes through that. And that's where Joshua is a type of Christ also. Because in the last day, we shall see exactly the same thing. if we're still alive when Christ returns, we shall see it with our eyes. If we die before he returns, we shall return with him, and we shall see how he destroys the man of sin, Satan's final stooge. Whether he's a person, whether he's a movement, I know not. But this man of sin, and we see him at work now, destroying the minds and the faith even of little children, polluting the world with his vile notions, and we shall see him destroyed with the brightness of Christ's coming. And that prefigures this Joshua as a type. His last task is to destroy the Anakim. So the giants of the mountains will fall in the end, and the Church of Christ will be triumphant. The two witnesses will be on their feet, as it were, in the symbolism of the book of Revelation, for that great final triumph day. So we can draw a lot from Joshua and the conquest in this 11th chapter. Let's close our thinking this evening, singing Jerusalem, Hymn of Triumph. It's hymn number 517. Hymn number 517, the way distrustful again. Satan in our lives. O Lord, take us in all our weakness.
and strengthen us that we may prove thee more and more as each day goes by. We ask these things in our dear Saviour's name, for his sake. Amen.
Amen.